Good morning, everybody. Morning. Come and take your seats. The cheap seats are down the front here if you want to come down the front. More expensive towards the back, it's entirely up to you. Good. Welcome to Waterfront. A very warm welcome. Our pastor, Arnallt Morgan, is going to be preaching this morning. Welcome if you're online as well. I'm going to start with just a quick reading. And can I ask the band to come forward as well, please, if that's possible? We're going to start with a song, but I'm just going to read a couple of verses. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, and 10,000s times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." I don't know whether you realize, as we lift our voices in praise this morning, we're joining in a song that has gone on for millennia and will carry on for millennia. We're not alone. We're not just a couple of hundred people in this building. There's people all over the world praising God. There's people in heaven, saints and angels praising God as well. So let's stand. We're going to sing to begin with. Max is going to lead us in the first song. Thank you.
City of God, the only way.
you. Take your seats. Thank you. A couple of announcements then for this week. Tomorrow at 2:30 at Verdi's, the Swansea Gospel Choir is doing an open air. If you're able to attend, please do so. If not, please pray for them. Remember them in prayer. It's a good witness to the people of Mumbles and the people who are visiting Mumbles on a bank holiday. A big congratulations to all those who had GCSE results. There are a couple of you dotted around, I know. Some people watching online probably as well. So really good. Well done. Hopefully we'll be praying for you for the next stage of your lives as well, what you're going to do next year. Can we also remember Sarah Griffiths in prayer? She's in hospital at the moment, going to be transferred to Singleton by the sounds of things. But please remember her and the family in prayer. She's not very well at the moment. Thank you. Now, Nicole. Where's Nicole? There you are. Do you want to come out the front, Bea? Nicole is coming to the end of her time in Hope House. You finished?
Yep.
Finished it now, right? She's finished now, so she's going on to the next stage. What are you going to be doing next?
So I'm going to be, I'm going to apply for health and social care to be a counsellor. I want to be a domestic violent counsellor.
Wow, okay. Well, we remember you in prayer with that. I've asked Meg Conway to come forward and open the meeting in prayer and also to pray for Nicole as well, if that's okay. Thank you.
Thanks. Let's pray, shall we? Father, thank you so much that you are a God of redemption. You're a God of love. You're a God of grace. You're a God of mercy and compassion. Father, I'm so thankful for Hope House. Father, we all are. We're so thankful and encouraged that you brought Hope House here to Waterfront Church. And Father, we're so thankful for the work of the women and the girls who come in. And Father, I pray for Nicole as she has completed a course. Thank you that you gave her the strength to complete the whole thing. Father, we pray that you would go with her in strength, that she would know your presence, she would know your love, she would know your hand upon her as she pursues this health and social to be a counselor. Father, I pray that it would be in your will, that it would please you that she would become a counselor, Father, that she would be able to help other girls, other people who need a friend, someone to talk to, someone to help understand things of life and other things. And Father, I pray, be with Nicole, go before her, go with her, be with her. I pray ultimately in all things she would trust you. I pray that she would be someone who depends on you and looks to you. And Father, I'm so thankful that in your word it says to show me your face. Let me hear your voice because your face is beautiful and your voice is lovely. Father, would Nicole show you her face? And would she give you her voice? Yeah, Father, I pray you'd help her run to you when the going gets tough. You first, you only. And I pray you'd help her have a church. Wherever she is located, would there be a church that love her, that welcome her, that she can serve in? And that she can continue to grow. Father, go with Nicole, we pray. And would she live the rest of her life every day giving glory to you as her God and Jesus as King. Thank you, Father, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Meg. And yes, Nicole, all the very best. Be with her in our prayers, as you all are, as everybody here is, I guess. Okay, if you've got your Bibles with you, can you turn with me to Mark chapter 3, please? Gospel of Mark, and that's going through bit by bit the Gospel of Mark, and we're going to start reading at verse 1 of chapter 3. Another time, Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Stand up in front of everyone." Then Jesus asked them, "Which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill?" But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts. He said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with Herodians how they might kill Jesus. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard all about what he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him to keep the people from crowding him. For he had healed many so that those with diseases were pushing forward to touch him. Whenever the impure spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." But he gave them strict orders not to tell others about him. It's God's word. Should we pray, and then the band is going to lead us again in a few songs. Heavenly Father, as we open our service this morning, we acknowledge that you are sovereign. That, Lord, you are God of gods, King of kings, Lord of lords. The only God who is worthy of our praise and our adoration, of glory. And Lord, we acknowledge that you are our God, that we are your people. And Lord, as we prepare our hearts to sing, as we prepare our hearts to praise and worship you, as we prepare our hearts to hear your word explained to us, Lord, I pray that we will put aside what's gone on this last week. We'll forget about what's coming this coming week, Lord God, and we will set our hearts and our minds on you. Lord God, you know each and every one of us. You know our cares and our worries, our concerns, our problems, our difficulties. You know about our health, physical, mental, emotional, spiritual. And Lord, I pray that your spirit will meet with us this morning, wherever we are, whatever position we're in, whether on the mountaintop or at the valley's bottom. Lord God, come in power this morning. May your spirit breathe on us this morning to open our hearts, open our ears, to hear what you've got to say. Lord God, make us want to hear what you've got to say. Help us to listen carefully. Help us to apply it to our lives, Lord God. Build this church, Lord God, so the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. Lord God, we want to see people come to you. If there's any here who don't know you this morning, Lord, I pray for the first time ever that you will open their eyes. Lord God, help them to see the risen Christ. Help them to see the value you placed on each and every soul in this place. Anybody who's listening online, Lord God, we want to see you. We want to experience you this morning. We want to know more about you. So Lord, bless Arnallt as he preaches. Lord God, I pray that you will anoint his lips, that the preparation he has done these last weeks, Lord God, it'll come to fruition this morning. That Lord, we'll know more about you. We'll go from here, people who are closer to you, knowing more of your love for us. And so Lord, as we sing now, I pray that you'll bless Mags and the band as they play and sing for us. Lord God, that our hearts will soar. We'll sing from the bottom of our hearts. We'll sing at the top of our voices to a God who loves us. And we ask it not for our own glory, but for the glory of your Son and for his sake. Amen.
Should we stand to worship the Lord?
Thank you.
Take a seat just for a moment, if you would, please. God has given us his word. And his word is true, and his word is honest, and it's holy. But God still speaks. Our brother's got a word that he wants to bring us this morning.
A verse of scripture came to my mind as I was sat there, and it burned into my heart. And Jesus was in the midst. And that to bless. And that's the word of God for you today, for every individual. Some have come, maybe you feel you're not worthy of blessing. Maybe you feel you cannot rise to the occasion. Maybe that you feel there are things in your life that are robbing you of blessing. But I'm here this morning, and by my Spirit, I want to move upon you and to bring a release of my purpose within you, so that you'll stand and recognize and know that your God is a mighty God. And to open your heart before me this morning, whoever you are, whatever your situation, whatever your background, however inadequate you might feel, however unworthy you might feel, just recognize this morning, I'm present in the midst of you, and I want to bless you, and I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless you through the ministry of my word. I've already blessed you through the singing of the songs. I'm going to bless you through everything that takes part in this service. And I'm going to pour an anointing on you this morning by the power of my Spirit. For I'm in the midst, saith the Lord, and that to bless.
I wonder if we could sing that last song again, please, Mags, if that's okay. I think it joins quite well, doesn't it, that God knows each and every one of us. He knows our hearts, he knows our minds, he knows our situations. As our brother said, bring it before him. God wants to use us. He knows our every heart, he knows our heart, he knows everything about us. So, yeah, just lead us in that before our last comes, please.
I have a maker. He formed my Thank you.
God speaks to us in a number of ways, and what we've just heard is Margaret with a tongue. And Byron's going to come and interpret for us now. Thank you.
My children, this morning, as you've already heard from me, I want to bless you. I want to pour out upon you. I want to just minister to each and every one of you as you would allow me. But you must allow me to come and fill you. You must allow me to come and speak with you. You must allow me to move upon your life. I am your Father. I am your God. And therefore, my dear ones this morning, know that I want to protect you. I want to love you. I want to just pour out upon you. My poured out love was shown on Calvary. The poured out blood of my Son was given for you. And therefore this morning I would ask of you that you would come to me. Allow me to protect you. The evil one would come and try and rob you of your blessing. You try and rob you of those things that I am putting in your heart and in your mind right now, the things I've already put in your mind through my servant. And therefore I would say to you now, my child, come to me. Come and blank out those things that would hinder the flow of my blessing upon you. As you listen to my preached word this morning, open your heart. Open your mind, blank out those things that Satan would try to do, and know that I am with you and I am for you, saith the Lord.
Let's just pray before Arnallt comes to speak. Heavenly Father, there are things we put in our lives that block us from seeing you, from hearing you. And Lord God, I pray this morning that you will break down those walls of separation. The Heavenly Father, in awesome power, you will break through, Lord God, into our lives. Even if we are Christians, Lord God, and we've put up barriers, Lord, I pray that you will tear them down this morning, whatever they are, physical, mental, emotional, whatever it is, Lord God, I pray that you will tear them down. Lord, if we have put anything on your throne, Lord God, you will tear it away and replace it with you. Lord, we want to see you this morning. I pray again that you will bless Arnallt as he speaks, that each and every one of us will be attentive to what you've got to say to us, Lord, that you'll build us up, that you'll strengthen us, that you'll encourage us, that you'll support us, that you'll pull us down if that's what we need, that you'll challenge us, Lord God, that we'll go from here changed people for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Well, good morning, everybody. Are you glad you're in church this morning?
Yes.
I've just felt something of the presence of God in the house this morning. From Paul's opening words to the prayers that have been said, to the prophetic utterances that we've heard, the worship. It's an exciting experience, I believe, to be in church this morning. September will begin the new academic year, but also a new ecclesiastical year as well. In the church calendar, September seems to be a new beginning. And I've got that sense of excitement that God is going to do something special among us in this year that lies ahead. And so on the 4th of September, there'll be a special prayer meeting here where we'll be praying into the new year that's ahead of us. So unless you've got a really good excuse, make sure you're here. So mark it in your calendar, 4th Monday, 4th of September, 7 p.m., an evening where we're going to engage with God in prayer. Well, we're continuing our study in Mark's Gospel, and we've arrived at chapter 3, and we're going to look at the whole chapter this morning, the whole of chapter 3. And in this chapter, first we see Jesus healing on the Sabbath, and this healing miracle that takes place on the Sabbath brings him at odds with the Pharisees and the religious leaders. We also find that as a result of his miraculous ministry, he draws a large crowd. Then later on, we find him identifying and commissioning his apostles to go and preach the gospel. And then, towards the end of the chapter, he reveals who are the ones who belong to the kingdom. So for me, this chapter highlights the three following points. First of all, we see the power of his person. The second thing you'll note is the purpose of his mission. And then the final thing, the people of his kingdom. Let's look at these individually. First of all, the power of his person. Let's read the first 6 verses again. Another time Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Stand up in front of everyone." Then Jesus asked them, "Which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or evil, to save life or to kill?" But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched out his hand, and his hand was completely restored. That's power. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. Here Jesus reveals his power by the healing of this poor man. This was power that the religious leaders were devoid of, and something which they could see was beyond human ability. In fact, later on in the chapter, these leaders try to attribute Jesus' power to the devil. Look at verse 22. "And the teachers of the law who came from Jerusalem said, 'He is possessed by Beelzebul, by the prince of demons. He is casting out demons.'" So from the very outset of Jesus' ministry, Mark shows us how Jesus begins to reveal his identity and power by healings and deliverance. And it's obvious from this chapter that Jesus was in their midst. And where Jesus is, things happen. And we were reminded prophetically this morning that Jesus is in our midst. And if Jesus is in our midst, the miraculous can happen here this morning. And of course, the greatest miracle of all is when someone becomes a Christian. And who knows? You may be sitting here or listening at home this morning and you don't know Jesus, but this morning he's in the midst and you can have an encounter with him and a life-transforming experience. Here in this chapter, you will note that even while the religious leaders fail to recognize the power and the person of Jesus, you would notice that the impure spirits, the evil spirits, recognize who he was. Look at verse 11. Whenever the impure spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." And John, in his third chapter of his gospel, records for us the discourse between Nicodemus, a great teacher of his day, and Jesus. And Nicodemus came secretly to Jesus by night, and while he didn't confess that Jesus was God, he did acknowledge that Jesus couldn't do what he was doing unless the power of God was at work within him. And so Nicodemus says, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God was not with him." When you think of the hatred of the religious leaders towards Jesus, It's not the fact that he performs miracles that disturb them, but rather what these miracles mean. His miracles and his power to forgive sin implies that he is God. In the previous chapter, you know, it is said that no one can forgive sins except God himself. And Jesus said, "Your sins are forgiven you." And so for these religious leaders, this is blasphemy. However, Jesus in Mark's gospel begins to reveal that he is indeed the divine Son of God. He is Emmanuel, God with us. And the Apostle John, in his opening statements in the first chapter of his gospel, begins with a recognition of the deity of Christ when he said, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh and made his dwelling among us." And Jesus here in this very chapter in his healings is beginning to unfold, to reveal to us something of his power, which reveals his person. And Paul, some years later, reveals the power of his person in his words to the church at Colossae when he describes Jesus with these words. He said, "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body. He is the beginning and the firstborn among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. For God was pleased to have all fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself, whether things on earth or in heaven, making peace through his blood shed on the cross. He begins to reveal it in Mark's gospel in the early chapters, and Paul has a glimpse of Jesus and his person and his power and his supremacy, and so he writes to the Colossians. And you know, today there are many in our world, just like the religious leaders, who get upset and offended by the person and power of Christ. He is incredibly offensive today to our political correctness fanatics. He is offensive to our multi-faith culture. Both Jews and Muslims find his claims intolerable. However, I must stand on Scripture, and I believe that this book is divinely inspired, inerrant, and my final authority in all matters of doctrine and practice. And so, therefore, this morning, when I think of his power and of his person, I must conclude with Richard Jukes, who said, "In him I see the Godhead shine, Christ for me, Christ for me. He is the majesty divine, Christ for me, Christ for me. The Father's well-beloved Son, co-partner with his royal throne, who bore the guilt of man alone, Christ for me, Christ for me." Yes, so here in this third chapter, the first thing we note is the power of his person. Jesus, my friend, is God, and therefore there is nothing that he cannot do. And this is our Jesus. Hallelujah. Then the second thing I want you to note is the purpose of his mission is revealed here. Look at verses 13 to 15. Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted. They came to him. He appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons. You see, Jesus had already revealed his mission earlier on in chapter 2 and verse 17, where he said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." And Luke, in his gospel, records these words of Jesus to us, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost." So Jesus came to earth on a mission to save humanity. And here in this gospel, Jesus moves a step further, calling to himself disciples who are to partner with him in this mission, and the mission is to spread the glorious news of the gospel. And at the close of his letter, his gospel, Mark says this: "The disciples went and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them, confirmed his word by the signs that accompanied it." And when Jesus calls them here in chapter 3, these disciples had no idea what the core message of the gospel they were to preach would be. However, in 3 years' time, they would understand its message and its power to save sinners. And 2,000 years have passed since Jesus called people to preach the gospel. And from that small group of 12 in that small nation in the Middle East, 2,000 years later, the gospel today is still being preached by men and women all over the world. And before the sun sets tonight, there will be men and women who will respond to its message and know its power. Hallelujah. Think of the wise words of Gamaliel, the great theologian of his day, when he spoke to the Sanhedrin when they sought to put the apostles to death for preaching this gospel. Listen to him. He says, "Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone, let them go. For if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourself fighting against God." And 2,000 years of church history has proven that this gospel is of God and is unstoppable. Think of some during the course of history that have sought to prevent the spread of the gospel. We had the Jewish leaders, religious leaders rather, during the early church. Then we had the Emperor Nero and other Roman emperors. Then we had Islam and their aim to slay all infidels. Then we had communism with its doctrine of atheism. Then we had Nazism with their evil and hatred. Now we have secularism, humanism, modernism, and all the other isms. However, the gospel has survived them all because the gospel, my friend, is an unstoppable gospel commanded by Christ to be preached globally, and he has promised that whoever preaches this gospel, he is going to stand with them. Let me remind you of the words of Jesus in Matthew's gospel, chapter 28. He says, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, even to the end of the age." My friend, this morning, God's plan and purpose for this world has not changed. It is still his plan that all men and women hear the good news of the gospel. The good news of Jesus' death and resurrection is unstoppable. Nothing can prevent its advance. Nero couldn't, Stalin couldn't, Hitler couldn't, and no force in today's world can either, because the message is unstoppable. I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. This Jesus that we meet on the pages of Mark's gospel and called apostles to preach his gospel still calls today. His mission for the church has not changed in over 2,000 years. Do you know, he has not called us to argue over Calvinism. He has not argued us to quarrel and argue over end times event. He has called us to preach Jesus as healer, as savior, as healer, as baptizer in the Holy Spirit, and as coming king. And friends, this is the gospel. And if God is advancing it, then no one can stand against it. No one has the slightest chance to overthrow it. It will prevail no matter what, because this gospel is unstoppable. The same Jesus who here in Mark calls men to preach the gospel is calling you and me to do the same. Listen, when you do spread the gospel, don't forget that God is with you. Don't be afraid of what is out there, because Jesus stands with you. And as David Jackman puts it, God is able to speak every language, able to be present in every place. God knows every thought and intention of every heart. He is an expert in postmodernism. He's an expert in Eastern mysticism and pluralism. He's an expert in Islamic thought. He governs the whole universe. He understands global warming and human genome project. He knows the plan of every terrorist cell across the planet. Quite simply, he says, the position of the ruler of the universe is not vacant, because God is in charge of it all. And this God has promised to stand with you and me when we engage with him in mission, in proclaiming the glorious news. And thank God, he says, and I will be with you always. So we see the power of his person, we see the purpose of his mission, and then bringing the chapter to a close, we see something of the people of his kingdom. Listen to verses 31 through to 35. Then Jesus' mother and brother arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in the circle around him and said, "Here's my mother and brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." Now, let's be clear. This is not Jesus dismissing his mother and family. At the cross, in his hour of agony, he asked John to take care of his mother, a sign of love and trust they share. The Bible speaks clearly of the importance of family. And when you read of love in the Bible, the first place it crops up is in Genesis 22. And it's to do with parental love. The love between Abraham and Isaac. When God calls him to take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. Family is important to God. But Jesus here highlights that true family is not a matter of biological relationship, but of kinship in obedience to God. And that the kinship begins when God, through grace, adopts us into his family. You see, God wants to have a family made up of all those, of all races, of all colors, of all sexes. He wants a family made up of those who believe in his son and seek to live in obedience to his teaching. And such people make up the kingdom that he is building. Look at verse 34, a very interesting verse 34. Looking about at those who sat around him a powerful and loving picture of the Lord's comprehensive love. The word translated looking about is used several times in Mark's gospel, and in each case it speaks of an intense, a deliberate, a searching gaze. And here we might characterize it as a gracious gaze. And this morning, as we find ourselves in church, the Lord is looking around. Has that intense gaze at you, my sister, at you, my brother, and he knows you, and he wants that intimate relationship with you. He is looking around this morning. Jesus said, I know my sheep, and I call them by name. So thank God in this day, in this year of grace, 2023, he is still looking around at who will come and sit at his feet, listen to his teaching, obey his word. You see, the gaze of grace welcomes sinners to come to this circle around his feet. And my challenge to you this morning is this: where are you sitting this morning? Are you outside? Or have you come in? Have you taken your place in that circle around the Master's feet? Because he wants you there. Because he wants you to become a part of his family. Listen to John in the first chapter of his gospel. He said, he was in the world, and although the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, and his own did not receive him. Yet to all who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. And this morning, he is building a kingdom. In the kingdom, there is a family. And in that family, there are those who believe in his name. And the door is open this morning so that you can come and sit and take your place as a family member. My friend, through Jesus this morning, we are part of God's family. We are adopted as sons and daughters of the King. And Paul, writing to the believers in Galatia chapter 4 and verse 6, says this: because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts. The Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. And if you remember this morning in that second prophetic utterance, it began with the words, my children. Hallelujah. He said, am your Father. And the hymn that we sang this morning, he knows my name. Hallelujah. This morning, I thank God for his searching gaze. He came to seek and save the lost, of which I was one. I didn't find him. He found me. And he, by grace and grace alone, invited me, despite knowing all about me. He invited me to be a part of his family. Isn't grace wonderful? You know, God knows everything about you. Thank God the person sitting next to you doesn't. And I'm there. But God does. And yet, despite knowing all there is to know about you, he invites you, dearie, come and sit at my J.I. Packer puts it like this: there is tremendous relief in knowing that his love to me is utterly realistic, based at every point on prior knowledge of the worst about me, so that no discovery now can disillusion him about me in the way that I so often disillusion myself and quench his determination to bless me. Hallelujah. Packer's got it. He's seen it. As kingdom people this morning, therefore, again we rejoice with Packer as he reminds us, I know him because he first knew me and continues to know me. He knows me as a friend, one who loves me, and there is no moment when his eye is off me or his attention distracted from me, and no moment, therefore, when his care falters. Thank God this morning, I'm a child of the King. Hallelujah. My friend, thank God for the person and power of Christ revealed in Scripture. Thank God that Jesus still wants us to partner with him in mission and spread this gospel of salvation about his death and resurrection throughout our land. And thank God that his gaze of grace still welcomes sinners to his circle and be a part of his kingdom family. And so I say with Vernon Higham, oh, let the praises of my heart be thine. For Christ has died that I might call him mine, that I might sing with those who dwell above, adoring, praising Jesus, King of love. Amen. Well, I have an important and exciting announcement to make to you this morning. And it's this, that the Apostolic Church, the denomination which we belong to, have recognized that Paul Ashman is a pastor in the body of Christ, and he will take his place as an associate pastor with me here at Waterfront. Isn't that great news? God is good, and his purposes roll on from generation to generation. And continue to pray for Paul and for Sue and the family as they take up new responsibilities. If you have any complaints about your bunions, from now on, see Paul. His ordination will take place here, so on date for your diary, Saturday, the 30th of September at 3 o'clock. If you've booked a holiday, just cancel it. Okay, so that's Saturday, the 30th of September here at Waterfront. Let's stand and bring our service to a close. What song have you for us, Mags? King of Kings, Majesty, Lord of Heaven, reigning in me. It's great to have Pastor Robin Price and his wife Gloria with us this morning. I'm sure I've seen them here somewhere, are they? Yes, they were. Robin, will you come and dismiss us with a word of prayer afterwards? We'll take up the morning offering as we're singing, and if you're a visitor, please feel at liberty in leaving the basket pass you by. Thank you.
Let's pray, shall we? Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you have drawn us into your family, a family of love. We thank you that those of us that were afar off, which were outside, you have made drawn us near by the blood of Christ. We thank you for the shepherd that loves us, that comes and seeks us when we wander. And we pray this morning, Father, that as we consider this message, as we see him who loved us, look at each one of us, but our gaze will not look down or look away or wander away, but will hold a fixed intent upon the eyes of love that have drawn us into that great family. Now bless us, we pray, not because we deserve it, but because of Jesus' merit. In the name of Jesus we ask it. Amen.